Guys, welcome to the I Love CVille Show. My name is Jerry Miller. It's good to be with you on a Friday. Thank you for joining us. We are live in the Commonwealth, the country, and the world on the I Love CVille Network. The last Friday in January of 2021, the month of January has steamrolled by, has it not? Folks, a lot we're going to cover on the show. A new vaccination site for Charlottesville and Central Virginia. We will continue the discussion from Real Talk this morning, the show we do on Tuesdays and Fridays at 10:15 in the morning on the I Love CVille Network with Keith Smith of the Yes Team Realtors. It was a fascinating discussion about the potential of 10th Street, and is 10th Street the new Belmont waiting to happen, and the potential for return on investment if you own property in 10th Street on what the value is now and what it could be once a development like Dairy Market and Dairy Central are completed. We will analyze that and unpack that topic on the program today. We will update you on Richmond, Virginia, the city of Richmond, its leadership, its council, its mayor's office, and their efforts to gain knowledge and data and intelligence on the value proposition of a casino in Richmond. Richmond has hired outside consultants from outside the state of Virginia to offer them consultation on casino potential for Richmond, who is clearly behind the eight ball like so many municipalities from a budget standpoint, thanks to COVID-19 and the damning impact COVID has had on tourism, on hospitality, on restaurant, on retail sales, and the taxable revenue that goes with those transactions. So Richmond has got a firm from New Orleans that they've hired to give them the nitty-gritty on the positive and cons of casinos. I'm going to ask this question on today's show. I have heard from leadership in Virginia Beach, in Norfolk, in Hampton Roads, in Richmond, in Bristol, Virginia, in Martinsville, Virginia, in Northern Virginia. Every little pocket of the Commonwealth, the leadership associated with those pockets has gone on record, either through hiring consultants, forming partnerships with the casino companies, or having votes in elections, asking citizens if they approve or disapprove of casinos. That's happened. It has yet to happen in Central Virginia. It has yet to happen in City Hall, in Charlottesville, in the Albemarle County office building with the Board of Supervisors. Why is that the case? We will ask that question of the program. We'll welcome Kelly Jackson to the show and get some ideas of what Kelly's watching in Charlottesville and discuss that UVA Virginia Tech game that's on Saturday. We thank Ting Fiber Internet for being a part of the program. You can save $288 on the best internet, the internet that is used to power this network. Ting Fiber Internet, crazy fast internet. You can save $288 only through this link, ilovecville.ting.com, ilovecville.ting.com, and you get 1 month free and free installation, a $288 savings. The positive of the show, Judah, if we can get the screenshot from the Blue Ridge Health District, and if you have not seen it, this will be news in the newspaper, on TV, and on radio. The Blue Ridge Health District is excited to announce a partnership with the University of Virginia to launch a new COVID-19 vaccination site at Seminole Square. Alongside support of the new Seminole Square vaccination location, Jaunt and Charlottesville Area Transit will offer transportation at no cost for individuals needing transportation assistance to and from vaccination appointments. That's amazing. I mean, that is amazing. The Blue Ridge Health District is currently prioritizing vaccinating phase 1A frontline healthcare workers, some phase 1B essential workers, and individuals ages 75 and older. Blue Ridge Health District, like other health districts, has a limited supply of vaccines. Virginia is not likely to meet the vaccine demand for 1B until March or April. That's brutal. Did you hear that? 1B demand will not be met until March or April. My father-in-law in Long Island, How old is he, Lou? 69? 68? Something like that, right? Father-in-law in Long Island? He right now cannot get the vaccine because they don't have enough needles. Literally, the needles to inject in people's arms. My mother-in-law, she's a nurse, one of the best people I know on this planet. Literally, she just has a zest for life. As a nurse, she has been vaccinated. So we are now eagerly anticipating my father-in-law to get his vaccination. And on Long Island, they don't have the needles needed to put the vaccine in people's arms. You know, I will get off this topic and talk about 10th Street and the 10th Street neighborhood in our prediction that 10th Street will become the new Belmont. And that we're just starting to scratch the surface for what 10th Street's true value is. Folks, dotting the I's and crossing the T's on the vaccination, it's clear that so much focus was put on the vaccination, the solution itself, and not a focus put on rolling out and getting the vaccination in people's arms. That's extremely obvious. So the idea was prioritized over the rollout of the idea, and as a result, we're left with this bottleneck or this long jam of getting injections in people's arms. I think we're going to go the whole year before this really gets rolled out, but time's going to tell. Props to the Blue Ridge Health District either way. Partnership with UVA, a second location. We'll see if we can get it out quickly. They're telling us it's going to be March or April before 1B demand is met. Consider that. The next story came up on the show. The next topic came up on the show we do this morning with Keith Smith on Real Talk. And we were interacting in this fabulous three-way conversation with Carrie Rock. And Carrie Rock is, he and his wife are the visionaries behind Do Good CVille, a charitable organization that creates positive goodwill and positive work for the Charlottesville community, whether it's a coat drive, a winter coat drive. Maybe we're able to figure out a partnership with Do Good CVille and this Charlottesville telethon that we're doing on the 12th of February here on the I Love CVille Network to raise money for affordable housing. But this was the topic that came up, and I'm curious of your take on this. 10th Street, the 10th Street neighborhood, it is in the spotlight for a number of reasons. The primary reason the 10th Street neighborhood is in the spotlight is because of Dairy Market and Dairy Central. And I've said Dairy Market and Dairy Central are the most impactful development in the city of Charlottesville in the last 20 years, 21 years. I first arrived here in the city of Charlottesville as a precocious first year at the University of Virginia. I was in August of 2000. So in the 21 years that I've been in Charlottesville, I am calling this the most impactful development in the city of Charlottesville in the 21 years I've been here. Now, I want to consider the 10th Street neighborhood. From my standpoint, 21 years of doing this, real estate is one of the businesses we're in, one of the three businesses we're in with 27 tenants and some commercial ownership and residential ownership in Charlottesville and Amarillo County. From my standpoint, 10th Street and that 10th Street neighborhood is just now on the brink of figuring out its true land value and home value potential. I think it's on the brink of being the next Belmont and frankly could have more positives working in its favor than Belmont. Allow me, please, to outline this argument for you. First, and let's compare and contrast 10th Street. 10th Street 2001 versus Belmont. 10th Street 2021, excuse me. 10th Street 2021 to 10th Street neighborhood in 2021 versus Belmont in 2001. Okay, so a 20-year comparison, 20-year difference. In 2001, I was finishing my first year at the University of Virginia. Belmont was very blue-collar. Belmont was not young professionals and bougie and Tony and white collar and young professionals looking to walk to the downtown mall to booze and get after it, or young families with kids that want to push their strollers to ACAC, the farmer's market, and get a latte before walking to Goodman or Little Graves or get Grave Street. In fact, I lived in Belmont. When did I live in Belmont, Tom and Shannon and Mike Henniger? I lived in Belmont off Little Graves in 2005. And in 2000, when I lived in on Little Graves in Belmont, that's right behind where Spud Nuts used to be, where Quality Pie is now. It's the first house, the second house on the left on Little Graves, I lived there. Me and three buddies lived there. We were broke jokes, like a year or two out of college. Broke jokes. We took a 1,000-square-foot home. Arthur Finer was our landlord, Ben's dad, fantastic landlord. We took like a 1,000-square-foot home, and we carved it into four bedrooms, air quotes, around bedrooms. And one of the four bedrooms, our buddy Shannon literally had to climb a rope ladder to get to the attic, drop-down attic. It had the pull-down thing where the stairs would come down and you'd shimmy up them. We took those stairs out. We replaced it with a rope ladder. And my buddy Shannon, for about $200, I think it was $180 a month, was living in an attic that did not have air conditioning. And shockingly, he was able to get girls to climb up this rope ladder on Thursday, Friday, Saturday night and have story time with him in the attic. Long story short, you had four dudes that were broke jokes. Me, Tom, Mike, and Shannon living in Belmont on Little Graves. I was paying like $300 a month. I think Mike and Tom, $300 a month. Shannon, like $180 a month. I think the rent was just under $1,100. And when we were living there, we were UVA guys leaving the bubble, going to Belmont. And initially, we were somewhat astonished in 2005 of how diverse the neighborhood was. It very much had blue-collar tendencies, which is the initial... Belmont was a blue-collar neighborhood for so long. Before now, it's bougie and white-collar and young professionals and the $500 strollers being pushed from Goodman and Graves and Little Graves to the farmer's market and the ACAC Kids Zone and then back down the downtown mall and back home for nap time. Okay, and in 2005, that wasn't the case. I remember walking home on a number of evenings from Belmont after striking out at the bar and having to come home solo and walking home at like 2:15, 3 in the morning and going through Belmont, and you're a little uncertain of what the surroundings were. Now, I'm going to tie this back to 10th Street. Belmont today is a $500,000 mecca. Belmont today is buy homes, tear them down, and build $600,000 McMansions. Belmont today is buy two lots that are adjacent to each other, combine the two lots, and next thing you know, you have an $800,000, $1 million piece of property. And I'm going to straight up say, I think that's going to be the future of 10th Street and the 10th Street neighborhood. And I think the 10th Street neighborhood has even more je ne sais quoi appeal because of its location in the city. The 10th Street neighborhood is closer to UVA than Belmont. The 10th Street neighborhood is closer to the UVA corner than Belmont. The 10th Street neighborhood is closer to Midtown and all those awesome restaurants than Belmont. The 10th Street neighborhood is closer to Scott Stadium, the John Paul Jones Arena, than Belmont. The 10th Street neighborhood is marginally further than the downtown mall than Belmont. The 10th Street neighborhood has the same tiny plots of land that Belmont has. I think you take Belmont 2001. Belmont in 2001 is 10th Street 2021. 10th Street, 5 years, 10 years from now, after Dairy Market and Dairy Central are finished, and after everyone in Charlottesville realizes that the only pockets left of affordable land to purchase are in 10th Street and Fifeville, maybe Prospect. Once we all realize that all the pockets of affordable land are gone, Belmont's gone, Greenbrier's gone, Johnson Village gone, North Downtown's gone, you're not going to find affordable housing in Woolen Mill, affordable land anymore in Woolen Mills. Maybe certain aspects of Hogwaller, you could get a piece of a land or two for some affordable, but Hogwaller's been uncovered. The last three spots you got are 10th Street, Prospect, and Fifeville. If you're going to get a piece of dirt, a postage stamp size piece of dirt at an affordable price point. You got you're in a real estate speculator or an investor. 10th Street, Fifeville, Prospect. And when Market and Central, Dairy Market and Central are done, and when we get out of this thing we call COVID, you will have young professionals chomping at the bit, just like we chomped at the bit to live in Belmont. You will have young professionals chomping at the bit to live in the 10th Street neighborhood, driving the value of that hood up, that neighborhood up, just like we saw in Belmont. So, that's my take. I'm curious what you think. Put it in the feed. Kelly Jackson coming up in a matter of moments. Aaron King, welcome to the broadcast. Barbara Lundgren, Johnny Ornelas, Ray Cradell. Candace Vanderlyn, hello. Welcome to the broadcast. Cara, hello from Ting. Hello, Patty Winchester. Patty, where are you watching? I see six states, Judah, watching the program. Thank you for watching the show. A couple of other items I want to get out of the notebook before I get to Kelly Jackson. Richmond, Virginia has hired a casino consultant. This casino consultant is from New Orleans. They are paying this casino consultant mega bucks to... You have that on screen, Judah? Thank you. The Richmond Economic Development Authority. I will repeat this. This is the organization... It's synonymous with the Charlottesville Economic Development Office. So the sister component or the similar office to what Charlottesville does from an economic development standpoint, the one in Richmond is called the Richmond Economic Development Authority. They voted on yesterday, to hire a New Orleans-based consultancy to offer them strategic perspective on casino development in Richmond and the value proposition of casinos for this city, Richmond. They're authorized to spend $120,000 on a consultant. $120,000. The reason I'm bringing this up to you is for the following. Norfolk and Virginia Beach are getting in the casino game. Richmond's hiring a New Orleans-based consultant. Martinsville and Bristol are getting in the casino game. So you got southwestern Virginia, you got Richmond, you got Norfolk and Virginia Beach, Hampton Roads wants to get in the casino game, Northern Virginia wants to get in the casino game. Why have we not heard or been communicated to in any capacity, from any department, at any level, in Albemarle County or the city of Charlottesville, from our elected leadership on casinos, whether pro or against? Why? Why are every other why are so many other municipalities, not every, but so many other municipalities in the Commonwealth, communicating with their voters and their taxpayers, this is our plan or this is what we're doing with casinos? But we haven't heard a thing from Charlottesville or Albemarle County. Why is that? Did you know you could bet online in Virginia right now? I'm going to do this. Online gambling, Virginia. Just typing it in Google. Online gambling, Virginia. I would encourage you to do the same thing. And when you do that, click the news tab. And when you do, you see online sports betting is on every media outlet that's covering Virginia. I'll read this article from NBC 12 in Richmond. FanDuel announced its launch 6 days ago on the 22nd of January in Virginia with a tweet on Thursday. So last Thursday, through a partnership with the Washington football team, this is the first form of legal sports betting in the Commonwealth of Virginia. You can gamble online right now. Local government is trying to build brick and mortar casinos. We haven't heard anything from our local government about this. I just find it curious. That's all I'm saying is I find it curious. All right, one more item out of the notebook and we'll get to Kelly Jackson. Number 8 UVA is at Virginia Tech on Saturday. The Hokies are 12-3, 6-2 in the ACC. UVA is 11-2, 7-0 in the ACC. It's 8 versus 20. The Hokies are without their second best player who just got popped on a gun charge. Yes, a gun charge. So UVA is a heavy point favorite in this matchup. That's a 6 o'clock tip on the ACC network. Interestingly, if you look at the ACC standings, and I'm going to call them up real quickly, if Virginia gets this victory, Tony Bennett's bunch, will have a pretty commanding control on the ACC, minus Florida State. So Virginia's 7-0 in the conference. The Hokies are 6-2. If Virginia wins, they go to 8-0. Virginia Tech drops to 6-3, and the Hoos have an edge in the tiebreaker head-to-head. Florida State is still 6-1 and is still there. I guess you can make the legitimate argument if Virginia wins this, the regular season in a lot of ways becomes a two-horse race with UVA and the Florida State Seminoles for the ACC regular season championship. The Wahoos will face Florida State on February 16th. This is the only matchup they have against Virginia Tech. If you beat Virginia Tech on Saturday, you win the head-to-head tiebreaker. Then you're at NC State, UVA is. You host Louisville at Georgia Tech, host UNC, and at Tallahassee, Florida State on February 16th in a game that's probably going to determine the regular season championship. UVA at Florida State, February 15th, 7 o'clock in Tallahassee. We'll follow the Hoos closely. I'm going to get to KJ, J-Dubs, Kelly Jackson, and I want to see what she's watching. She's a woman about town. KJ's on the line. KJ, ¿qué pasa, chica? How are you?
Hey, hey, I'm freezing to death, Jerry.
Is it colder at your house or in this studio?
Ugh, it's a close tie.
So you're saying it's like 61 degrees in the Jackson Estate?
Yes, it's freezing here. We're waiting for the snow.
Okay. Okay, I got a serious question for you.
Okay.
I just got this text message here. Best places to go sledding with kids in and around Charlottesville.
Okay. Covenant High School.
Okay.
Has a ginormous hill that goes onto their big, like, soccer football field.
Okay.
It's super steep. It's super fun. I say that's number one.
Okay. Covenant High School. Kelly Jackson's already coordinated clearance with the fabulous Mo Gaffney for all of us to hit the hill at Charlottesville at Covenant. Okay, that's high school. Mo's lower school. So you're saying that's the best hill for sledding?
If you want it steep and fast.
I want it steep and fast. Don't you want it steep and fast?
Yeah. Oh, and then Farmington.
Yeah.
On their back nine has a super steep hill too, but they kind of get pissed.
Because you're tearing up the golf course.
Right. But it's worth it if you don't get caught.
Does Rick give us the green light to do that in Farmington?
I mean, it's his grandkids. He'll let them do anything they want.
Kelly Jackson, co-star, guys, of Women Changing Our World, Mondays at 10:15 a.m. on the I Love CVille Network. She and Jamie Schwartz entertain, inform, and have a hell of a lot of fun. My friend, what are you watching? What are you watching in Charlottesville? What are you seeing? What's on your mind?
Well, I'm worried about the vaccines. First of all, I went on and filled out my form, right?
Are you 1B?
I'm 1B.
Okay.
But, so you get a list of, like, if you're 16 and older, are you high risk for health? Guess what is listed on there?
What?
If your BMI is 25 or above.
So if you're, okay, I'm going to cut to the chase. Can I say it?
Right. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to cut to the chase. So you may have an edge of getting the vaccine faster than somebody else if you're fat?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
That doesn't seem fair to me.
Okay, I think so too. But then listen to this. Not the way, you know, I've spoken about it publicly. I've lost a ton of weight. My BMI index, I weigh 140 pounds. I'm like 5'4". And I wear a size 6 pants. I am considered fat.
No, you're not.
Yeah, if you look up your body max index, I qualify to be ahead of everybody else in the vaccines because my BMI is 25.5.
So this is probably the first time in your life that you're absolutely embracing this and saying, hell yeah.
Hells yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah. You, Kelly, I sincerely mean this. Sincerely mean this. You're like the most petite, tiny person ever.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. But listen, if that gets me like an edge to
take
get
it.
The vaccine quicker, I'm taking
so
it.
So what kind of edge do you get?
You're in the high risk category in 1B. Also, what's on there, if you vape, you get
what
pushed up too.
Are you serious?
Yeah, go on. If you go on the Blue Ridge, you know, health department, click on 1B, and then it'll say, like, are you high risk health wise? And it has like a whole list of things. And then when you fill out the form, you can check all the boxes.
Oh my gosh. So, Kelly, this is great. I this is why we bring her on the show. I had not even realized this. So, if you smoke things and overeat, you can get your life saved faster than people that exercise and don't smoke things.
Yes.
That is crazy, right?
That's insane.
That is insane. That is insane. That is very good. This is why we have her on the show here. That is fantastic. What do you make of that?
I mean, first of all, I'm not fat. So who's making like these standards of BMI? Who is that? Because they're crap, right? But also like, so you're telling me, like, my dad, who's 70-something and is a marathon runner.
Yeah, he's super skinny.
I'm super fit.
Yeah.
But his body mass index is, like, you know, zero body
right.
fat. So that means I'm going to get it before he does? That's insanity. I don't know who's making those rules.
Are you? So does that mean, does that literally mean you get, how old is your dad?
Like 73.
You get the shot before Rick?
Well, I'm in the same line.
Holy crap.
Okay, and here's some other news, Jerry. I'll spill the tea on your show. If COVID vaccine locations, if people have an appointment and don't show up, they've already taken the vaccines for that day out of the refrigeration system. So instead of throwing the vaccines out, if you show up at like 5 to 5:30, if they have things left, regardless if you have an appointment or not, regardless of where you are in line, they will give it to you.
How do you know this?
Because I know people who did it.
Okay, so you're saying you know people who showed up to the Kmart location at essentially last call, because that's basically the last call for the vaccine. It's like last call for alcohol, last call for shots.
Yeah.
And these people got the injection?
Yep.
Holy shit. How many people do you know that did that?
Four.
Four? Dude, and don't you think there should be a punishment for the people who sign up and don't show up?
I mean, I don't fault the people giving the vaccines because what are they going to do, just throw it out?
Oh, yeah, I don't fault them at all. Yeah, they're doctors and they're like, let's get it in people's arm. At least getting it into someone's arm is better than throwing it in the trash.
Right. Yeah, but like if you make an appointment, you should, like, be fined or something if you don't show up.
I mean, if we're taking credit cards for people making reservations for a four-top at a restaurant and charging their credit card if they're missing their reservation, we freaking better pop them if they're missing their vaccination. Is that right?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I don't know. Okay, and then on this, while we're on this vaccine front, I agree with you with what you said. I don't think there's going to be enough vaccinations or enough people to give them until the end of the year. And what's that leading me to is some of these small businesses that have hung on tooth and nail for the last 10 months, they're not going to make it through the summer. And especially things like, I'm thinking of kids stuff, because the kids vaccine's not out. So what does that do to, like, movie theaters? Bounce and play? Right? Like, little gym? Like, all the kid kind of centric activities. What happens to all those?
That's a great question. And you remind me of a conversation I'm having now with my wife. Everyone is talking about vaccinations, but they're not talking about vaccinations with kids, which makes every mom a little apprehensive. What's your stance on this here? I mean, are you totally going to have relief as a mom of two beautiful daughters until they're vaccinated? Or do you see it as like the numbers are so small of the kids that are dying here, it's not something to think about or worry about?
I'm not going to worry about it yet. I want to, first of all, I think a lot of people who live in Charlottesville, Albemarle County are like pro-COVID vaccine. We're not living in like Texas or Oklahoma where they're like, screw it, COVID's not real, I'm not wearing a mask. I mean, I think Charlottesville, I think a majority of the people, given the chance, will take it.
I agree.
Which I think will make our numbers so low that the chances of our kids getting it, there's not enough people that have it to give it to everybody, is my hope.
Okay, so not worried about the daughters right now.
No, I mean, we're still inside. I think, but come summer, when a majority of our population, I hope, is vaccinated, I'm hopeful that, you know, the numbers will be low. And then it brings you up to schools. Now they're saying open all the schools. I haven't seen that data yet.
Do you want to open the schools?
Well, my kids go to private school. So, you know, it's open. I didn't feel comfortable sending them for my situation, but also like at the start of the school year, we really knew nothing about COVID. If schools open back up next year, I'm going to send mine.
In the fall?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. You liked something that was on the menu at Firefly.
Yes. Okay. So I have alpha gal. So I got bit by a tick way back when. And it made me allergic to mammal products, which is like pork and beef. And Firefly, I totally dig. Shout out to you. They do a Beyond Meat sausage and pepper. Completely vegan on a vegan roll. It is killer.
You're going to get it?
It's killer. Yes. It's delicious. It's delicious. So there's that. What do you think is going to happen with... Downtown, Jerry.
Downtown Mall?
Yeah.
I think to your point, if the vaccinations don't get out fast, here's the thing. Richmond's Health District sent out a tweet. We talked about this, I think, yesterday, that even if you get vaccinated in Richmond, the Health District in Richmond is saying, even if you get vaccinated, you still have to wear a mask. You still have to be 6 feet apart from people. And socially distance. So how, you're in the restaurant business, how can a restaurant, especially with like a one unit restaurant, a mom and pop restaurant, how can they survive if the guests have to stay 6 feet apart, even after getting vaccinated?
No, that's going to be impossible. And think of like one of my favorite restaurants, Tavola, Beaumont. Love that place. One of my favorites in Charlottesville. It's teeny in there. I mean, if you have to be 6 feet apart, they're going to have like four people.
Right, right, right. So how do you reopen if the health district in Richmond is saying everyone who gets vaccinated still has to be 6 feet apart? How do we reopen?
That's the point. I mean, and I think this is going to be the rule for at least the next year.
Yeah.
If not more.
So what are you going to do?
I don't know.
What do you have a number of business interests then. What are you guys doing from a business interest standpoint to adapt to what's happening?
Well, we were quick movers. We were kind of the first movers, at least locally Charlottesville, because we had the access, meaning we have drive-through. You know, we are already doing delivery. We already were doing rapid pickup where you could order online, run in the front door and grab it. Really, the piece that we added was that we would run it out to your car. Restaurant-wise, I don't think any of those things are ever going to go away. So we're lucky because of our locations, we can do all those things. But these mom and pops, one-offs, delivery is expensive. Okay, like Grubhub, Uber Eats, all these places take so much.
A third.
I mean, it's insane.
That's insane. That's all the profit. You're basically playing the Grubhub game for the brand exposure.
Right.
And that don't pay the bills.
No, it doesn't pay the bills.
She is connected and helped make an interview possible on this network this week with the husband and wife dynamic duo behind Alboro Cannabis Company. That interview was amazing. I'm grateful for you. She set the interview up. Literally, she was texting them during her show, and when her show was still happening, I got a text message from the owner saying, I can do it. Shows you how versatile she is. What do you make of their future? Alboro Cannabis Company, and the whole industry in general. Dude, it's going to freaking boom, right?
It's going to be huge. And this is what I think. You were talking about casinos.
Yeah.
Me personally, I hope Charlottesville doesn't go that direction.
Casinos? So you don't want casinos in Central Virginia at all?
I don't want them in Charlottesville. Okay.
Is Alboro County okay down 5th Street extended right across from the Mosby neighborhood?
No. Okay. First of all, I'd be broke because I love to play slots and blackjack. So that would be too convenient, Jerry. No, I mean, I don't know. I would rather not do it. I envision Charlottesville. I want it to be a foodie kind of place with great local restaurants. I want it to be about the vineyards and the breweries. And then I think adding this cannabis piece to Charlottesville, you know, it's kind of like the Boulder of our coast. And I hope that feel stays. I think the cannabis business and Albemarle Cannabis is going to blow
up. Me too.
And I liked their vision. They weren't just like wanting to be a head shop, you know, on the corner. They like take real pride in what they're doing, take real pride in their product. And they aren't saying that they want to be something that they're not.
I love it. Oh, so what's your crystal ball say it looks like 5 years from now?
I think it's going to be a huge booming business. Although I will say, I don't think the money is in the growing. The
retail.
Money is in the
retail. Yeah, yeah. I mean, because the markup is obscene.
Well, obscene. And think the government's going to take how
a
much
third,
in taxes?
30%.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so that just shows you how much the markup is. If the government is taking a third and they're still able to profit on it substantially, it shows you how high the markup is from growing to retail.
Yeah, and I wouldn't be surprised if you see people in the hemp business right now looking for large plots of land all over Central Virginia.
Oh, talk to me about that.
Well, right, I mean, you need a lot of land to grow.
Yeah.
And it, you know, you need the soil, you need, you know, whatever, hopefully like a, you know, local water source. So think you can't just have, I mean, you could have 1 acre, but that's not going to make you anything. I mean, I think any big plots of land, 50 to 100 to 200 acres, if they're available, I think they'll be snatched up quick.
All right. Well, a few more questions on this. You guys, okay. In a way, you guys are some private equity that do investing in a number of different businesses. Your family. I think that's safe to say. Okay. That's a decent description. So as someone that does that, you and your family, how would you go about the opportunity that's on the horizon?
I would want to invest. If the numbers look good currently with a cannabis company, and they have connections, they have good product. I like what their vision is. It aligns with how I want to run a business. I'm down. I'd be in it. I want to be in it.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Hit me up if you guys are in the cannabis business and need some
capital,
business partners.
A capital strategy and knowledge they can certainly offer. All right, the show's yours. Anything we're missing and we want to cover that should get out there?
Huh. Please get your vaccination if your number comes up. Go on and fill it out. If you're fat, you get to jump the line. I'm interested to see what happens to the downtown mall. Keep an eye on the downtown mall. And keep an eye on 5th Street Station. What's going to happen there?
Well, I mean, you know more than I do. I mean, you got a Panera there. I mean, what's going on there?
Yeah.
I mean, our friend Jamie was being very straightforward on Women Changing Our World about Picasso Swig and the vacancies that are at 5th Street Station. I mean, what's the nitty-gritty there?
I have no idea. They say they have some retail coming in that's clothing. My guess is it's going to be, if they're truthful, which I hope they are, my guess it's going to be like a TJ Maxx or a Marshalls or a some clothing thing like that.
And would you be, how would you feel about that as a Panera owner?
Sure.
You like that?
Absolutely. Any business in that shopping center is better than no business.
There you go. What do you think it is? Is it like 40% vacant?
I think so. Well, think, because Aramark had all of those restaurants on either side of the movie theater.
Yeah.
And they legit, COVID started, they locked their doors with all of their equipment and everything in there and never came
They
back.
Never came back.
No, never came back. Like their chairs, their kitchen equipment, everything is in there. They literally, COVID, got it closed, locked the doors, never came back.
Do you think they come back as a tenant or are they pieced out of Fifth Street Station forever?
They're pieced out.
Forever?
They were like, I think so. This was kind of like a test for them. You know, because they're in like all the colleges and all the stuff. They were trying to see if the connections they had with the restaurants they put in to college, if they could then leverage those connections and make these block group of different restaurants outside of colleges. So this was kind of their first test.
This was their first? Like, this was Aramark's first test into standalone restaurants was Fifth Street Station?
Yeah, for my knowledge.
Holy crap. And it's like the worst timing ever for that test. And it's actually a really good idea because they own like Caribou Coffee, the BurgerFi, the Wing Zone, all these brands where the college kids get touched by the brand and build a relationship while in the cafeteria for 4 years. And then the thinking is once they establish that relationship with the college kid, that when they get a job out of college, they will want to continue that relationship by patronizing a standalone restaurant.
Right.
And their first test was COVID?
Yeah. And they opened literally like 2 weeks before everything had to shut down.
Yeah, such bad timing. Oh, my gosh. Kelly, you're awesome. How about Monday show?
Well, hopefully, if it doesn't snow or if I can get down my mountain, we have Mina from HGTV, the show Good Bones, which is awesome. And then the week after that, people are very excited about this. Hannah from the Bravo show Below Deck is coming on. And it was quite the controversy when she got kicked off the show.
Whoa. Wait, is Monday's show at 10:15 a.m. or is this a change in time show?
No, next week is at 10:15, but the week after is going to be at 5:30 because Hannah lives in Australia.
Right.
So she's like 14 hours ahead.
So Monday at 10:15 a.m. on Women Changing Our World on the I Love CVille Network, she has two legitimate HGTV stars.
Yeah.
I mean, they're big time, right?
Yeah, they're like the number one show on HGTV.
Yeah, nicely done. Hey, best interview we have done yet.
Yeah, it's always fun, Jerry. Send me your sledding pics.
I will. And if you hit Covenant, send us the pics too.
Okay.
You have a good one.
You too. Happy weekend.
You too, KJ. Good stuff from Kelly Jackson right there. I love it. Kelly Jackson and Jamie Schwartz on Monday have superstars from HGTV on their show here in the Macklin Building on Market Street in the I Love CVille Network. They are getting global guests on their show. Global guests on Women Changing Our World. How big time is that? All right, if you have comments you want to relay, put the comments in the feed. Ahmad Hawkins, what's up, buddy? Salute to you as well. Ahmad Hawkins, the ball hawk watching the show. I love Ahmad Hawkins. Please, please, please watch anything Ahmad Hawkins does in the ball hawk on his podcasting network. It is fantastic. Ahmad Hawkins, I love you, Ahmad Hawkins. Someone tell Ahmad Hawkins I said that. I love you, Ahmad Hawkins. Jamie Schwartz, she says mammals are gross. You mean that from an eating standpoint, right, Jamie? Because you like mammals from a pet's standpoint. And Jamie, are you still giving away those two birds? Those two birds need a good home. Have they found a home on your Facebook page yet, Jamie Schwartz? We're happy to help. I don't want to adopt the birds. I don't want the birds, Jamie. But we will happy get the word out about the birds. Vanessa Parkhill says, some neighboring counties have staff ready to administer vaccines, but no supply. Such a bummer, and she's exactly right. Some counties in Central Virginia have vaccines ready to inject, but they don't have the people to do it. How sad is that? We have vaccines ready to go, but not the personnel to put it in people's arms. Ray Cadell's watching the show. Just an FYI, some wedding dates in May and June 2021 throughout Virginia are now postponing and canceling because of COVID. Good night. So it's not just Q1, but deep into Q2. That's not good for the financial health of the wedding and event community. Many of these are postponing into 2022. Ah, I'm sorry to hear that, Ray. So a lot of the Q2 events, he said, for 2021 are now postponing into 2022. Ray also says, by the way, I am 1B and 66 years old, type 2 diabetic. No appointment. I can't get an appointment. My 90-year-old mother in Florida cannot get an appointment. Ray Cadell. Ray Cadell, we appreciate that honesty and that perspective. Neil Williamson's watching from the Free Enterprise Forum. He says, guys, growth restrictions impacted Belmont's changes. As these restrictions, especially Albemarle, have not changed or gotten worse, will this push prices up? What does that do for a diversification of housing types? Great question. I can answer this from, So, 53%, roughly 53% of land in the city of Charlottesville is zoned R1 for a single family detached home. So more than half the homes in the city of Charlottesville, that land is zoned R1 and can only have a single family detached home on it. There are only 10.2 square miles that make up the city of Charlottesville. So you have this really tiny piece of property that's called, this really tiny 10.2 square mile area that's called Charlottesville. And in that 10.2 square mile area that's called Charlottesville, 53% of the land is designated as single family detached housing. So if you have people from outside the area looking to move to Charlottesville, we know they want to do that because they have four magical years at the University of Virginia, the four best years of their life, and then they wax nostalgic and they say, man, I miss those four great years we had. Maybe we will relocate and start anew here in Charlottesville. So that's happening. It's the allure that the university brings, the time at the university, and that allure bringing people back. That's one factor. The second factor, you got historically low interest rates, rates that we've never seen in the history of our lifetimes and probably will never see again, that's influencing people to move. The third factor, Realtor Magazine last week did an expose, and this goes out to every realtor in America, and in this story in their magazine, they said that Charlottesville metropolitan area was the second most popular area for retirees to move to in America. Waynesboro metropolitan area was third. Roanoke was fourth. Orlando was one. So you have the allure of the University of Virginia bringing people back. You have historically low interest rates encouraging people to buy. You have retirees moving to the Charlottesville metropolitan area at frequency and clips we've never seen before, the Waynesboro area as well. You have the influence of COVID that is pushing people from densely populated areas to more suburban areas like Charlottesville, allowing them to work remotely via Zoom and Skype and Teams and software while maintaining their big city income but living in a community like this so their dollar goes further. Long story short, all these factors will continue to drive up the cost of housing in Charlottesville, making those that own housing in the Charlottesville metropolitan area richer and wealthier, and unfortunately, negatively impacting those that do not own housing in the Charlottesville and Central Virginia area, because every day that goes by, it becomes harder to actually own and acquire because the cost of living is going up. There it is in a nutshell. That's what's happening. That is what's happening. And this nutshell that I just presented to you further strengthens my argument about the long-term return on investment of the 10th Street neighborhood, on how it's basically Belmont waiting to happen. And when Belmont happens in 10th Street, when blue collar becomes white collar, when subcontractors become yuppies and young professionals in the 10th Street neighborhood, the potential of 10th Street is greater than the potential of Belmont, because 10th Street is closer to UVA, Midtown, Scott Stadium, and John Paul Jones Arena. And now Dairy Market and Dairy Central. It's a more convenient place to live than Belmont. We'll see what happens. Barbara Lundgren, it takes 40 years for our leaders to do anything. Perfect example, no convention center in Charlottesville. We need a convention center. She is so right. Barbara Lundgren, we have a great hill on the farm. Bring wine. Hopefully the cow pies will be totally frozen. That's funny, Barbara. My backyard has cow pies, but those are from Max and Leo, our German shepherds. Stephanie, I've been preparing for this vaccine since COVID hit, and I didn't even know it. I love it. She's talking with Jamie Schwartz right now. Jamie Schwartz has one more thing. She says the birds are gone. She says, I think all businesses are having a hard time convincing people to come out, either to eat indoors or to leave their houses with their children. No one can push or force the market until this is over, and I am nervous for all our local businesses. Creativity and pivoting only go so far. Jamie, I feel your pain. I feel your pain on that one, Jamie. I really do. She's done so many things for Picasso Swig and to pivot and to reinvent that business. So many things. But if the marketplace does not have confidence for people to come in the door, if a large portion of the market is not confident about walking in a door, what can you do? What can you do? Amanda Burns giving us some props. Hello, Amanda Burns. Welcome to the broadcast. I see tomorrow is your birthday. Okay, gosh, JoJo, I didn't mean to upset you. JoJo Robertson, all right. She said, seriously, Jerry Miller, some people don't choose to be fat. This convo really pissed me off. Poor people are fat because they do not have the funds to go to Trader Joe's or Whole Foods. That's one reason we are fat. We have to use food banks. That is not always healthy. Think about that while you eat all your comfort food. We don't have a choice, Jerry. Okay, I apologize, JoJo Robertson. I apologize. I made this comment. Kelly Jackson, when talking about the vaccine, folks that are vaping, smoking chemicals into their body, and folks that are overweight and have a BMI, body mass index, over a certain threshold, they are prioritized when getting the vaccination over people that are skinny. So it's not, this is an appropriate statement that is accurate and by no means demeaning what I'm about to say. Overweight people are prioritized versus healthy weight people in getting the vaccination. That's a fair statement. Overweight people are being prioritized for getting the vaccination over healthy weight people. And if you vape and smoke chemicals into your body by your personal choice, for some reason, if you vape and smoke chemicals into your body, you get the vaccine ahead of people who do not smoke chemicals into their body. Kelly Lewis says, they are not making fun of overweight people. BMI is the measurement of body fat based on height and weight that applies to both men and women. You can calculate yours yourself and find if you're able to get the vaccine sooner than others based off it. Right, Kelly, that's right. I was not making fun of fat people. I was not doing that. And I understand the concept of food deserts and how food deserts often coincide with areas or pockets of low-income housing. I understand that concept as well. I certainly was not making fun of fat people. Okay, I said fat. I'm sorry that the word fat bothered you, JoJo. I apologize. I'm sorry I used the word fat instead of overweight. I apologize, JoJo. Thank you for holding me accountable. I should not have said fat. I should have said overweight. Thank you. Kyle Irvin, who's the marketing director of Charlottesville Almoral Transit, is watching the program. And Kyle Irvin says, hope you're having a blessed day, my man. vaccination transportation, CATS Route 7 and Charlottesville Outbound Transit's Route 8 will get you directly to your appointment at Seminole Square. Kyle Irvin, Knowledge Bombs. So Charlottesville Outbound Transit's got a bus. Route 7 and Route 8 will get you directly to your appointment at Seminole Square. Kyle Irvin, Marketing Director of Charlottesville Outbound Transit. Thank you for that knowledge. Melissa Denham is watching the show. I'm a nurse and can help get vaccinations out. Thank you. Nurses are heroes. Thank you. We would love any help you can do. All right, that's the show. One more thing. JoJo, this is important. JoJo Robertson, if you're watching, I think you can get behind this, okay? Please help us spread the word. On the 12th of February, February 12th, it's a Friday, from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. right here on the I Love CVille Network, we will stay on air for 12 hours straight with the goal of buying two pieces of property through crowdsourced donations, and the Thomas Jefferson Community Land Trust would take our donations and then buy land on 10th Street and buy land on Carlton and Monticello. And if we could crowdsource $300,000, it's going to take 6,000 people in Central Virginia. Central Virginia is made up of 300,000 people. So 6,000 people is 2% of the population. If 2% of Central Virginia, 6,000 people, give $50 each, we have $300,000 that's been crowdsourced through donations. And that money will go to the Thomas Jefferson Community Land Trust. And the Thomas Jefferson Community Land Trust will be able to buy land on 10th Street and a piece of property at the intersection of Monticello and Carlton. Can you get those photos on screen, Judah, from Keith and Real Talk? The first photo I'd like before we get out here is the plot of land on 10th Street, if you could. It backs up to Dairy Market and Dairy Central. Let me know when that's on screen, please, sir. Facebook, I'm going to ask you to look at the screen here, then I'm going to get off air. That's on screen, J-Dubs? Okay, thank you very much. Let me know when that's up there. Okay, it's on screen. Look at the screen, Facebook. Look at the screen. This is the piece of property on 10th Street. Backs up to Dairy Market and Dairy Central. If we're able to raise $150,000, the first $150,000 goes to buy that land through the land trust. Now let's show the Carlton and Monticello Google Map or Google View. Please, let me know when that's on screen, sir. The second piece of property, which is also roughly $150,000, is Carlton and Monticello. Let me know when that's on screen. If we can raise $300,000, the second $150,000 will go to the purchase of this land that I believe, oh, he has on screen. You got it on screen, J-Dubs? Oh, I thought you had it. Let's show them the finished product, Nassau Street, if you could do that, the houses. This is what they'll look like. If we do $300,000 and get 10th Street and also the piece of property on Monticello and Carlton, it's going to translate to 11 units of affordable housing tied to area median income. They're going to be net zero houses, basically no overhead, $200,000 price point. Look at them. They're dope. These houses are super dope. 1,500 square feet. To put that in perspective, you can buy right off of Market Street here, a condo listed at $250,000 that's 600 square feet. These are over two times that size for $50,000 less. And they have green space. All right, so please, JoJo, if you could help. 12th of February or Friday. Yeah, we're going to do that. Mr. Guy, F-U-U-D Guy, we're going to do that. We're going to have, he says, any thoughts about an auction with all your connections, Jerry? I'm sure you can put together some items for people to bid on. We're going to have a ton of prizes. So basically the concept, and we're still fleshing this out with Susan, we're working on the ideas here. Basically the concept is, we need 6,000 people to give $50. If you're one of the 6,000 people to give $50, you're going to get in the running for prize bundles. And we'll start picking your name, like every 15 minutes we'll pick a name. And these prize bundles could be, you know, gift cards to restaurants, gift cards to Animal Connection. Susan Steinmar from the Land Trust has got a freaking car that we can give away. Like a vehicle that we can give away. A car in pristine shape that we can give away. And that vehicle is going to go to folks that contribute to the donation. So every 15 minutes we'll pick another name. So there is incentive for you to contribute to this effort. Not only can you drive by 10th Street West, 10th Street, when these units are done, get them back on screen, Judah. Get the Nassau streets on screen. How dope would it be? How dope would it be if you drove down Monticello and Carlton? How dope would it be if you drove down 10th Street West and you saw these houses and you said to your kids in the back seat, your husband that's sitting shotgun, we helped build those houses for a family in this community that wanted the American dream of home ownership. Our money went to that. I mean, and it's taxable donation, and it's a taxable write-off. It is a taxable donation. You're doing the right thing. You have a chance to get serious prizes that we're offering, including a freaking car. It's never been done in Charlottesville history. Crowdsourcing land to build affordable housing. Charlottesville City Government and Albemarle County Government have no money because of COVID. All those promises about affordable housing, they don't have any money because of COVID. We have to do a private-public partnership if we're actually going to have a freaking impact in this town. And we're going to lead the charge because that is what it's all about as a social entrepreneur or a conscious capitalist, someone committed to running a business for profit in the black, but with a mindset of leaving his or her footprint in a better place than when he or she first arrived as the visionary business owner of the business. That's what we do. All right, I'm out of here. I got to get to work. Jerry Miller, Judah Wickhauer, I Love CVille Show. We love you guys. Freaking love you guys. Have a good one.